Welcome back to Northwest City Politics in the Know with Juanita. We're glad to have you with us again this evening for our show. We're always happy for people like you, people that are interested in the issues that are happening in our cities. Because it is important for good government that the city council, the city staff, and the residents all communicate together so that you know what's going on in areas that are of particular interest to you, you let them know. So we're glad that you're with us. And if you haven't watched our show before, each week we'll have somebody on from one of the 9 cities in Northwest Communities viewing area that can update us on the issues and the current happenings in that particular city. So we're glad to have you with us. And tonight, we're very happy to have Mayor Tim Wilson with us.
Good to be here.
From Brooklyn Center. Long-term, you've been with us almost since the beginning of our show many times. So we're happy to have you with us again.
Yep, almost 10 years in office already.
Right.
So, yeah.
So, you know that I would like you to introduce yourself out to our wider audience. Tell them a little bit about yourself and your background.
Well, yeah, my name's Tim Wilson. I'm the mayor here in Brooklyn Center. I've been the mayor the last 10 years. I'm in my third term.
Right.
I'm not up for re-election this year. I will be in 2 more years in 2018, and I, at least at this point, plan on running then again as well. So I do have a life-changing event coming up on July 5th. I'll retire from my I shouldn't say real job, because being the mayor's real job too, but I'll be retiring from my job that actually feeds my family, that whole type of thing, and in which case I'll have much more time
to
do things as the mayor and get involved in a lot more nonprofits. I have a very strong awareness of the opioid addiction that's going on as well. So there are a lot of things I'm looking forward to being able to do in retirement. So.
Yeah, and then you can pick and choose.
Yep.
Put your time where you'd like to put it.
Yep.
So. And then I asked you to think a little bit about Brooklyn Center. And is there something about Brooklyn Center you can tell our audience that many people wouldn't know? Maybe Brooklyn Center people, but something about Brooklyn Center that might tweak their interest.
Well, I think the most interesting thing at Brooklyn Center over the years is that crime has been lowered almost 40 to 50%.
Right.
Brooklyn Center in some of the times past had a little bit of a bad rap as far as crime was concerned. We've put extra resources into that. The city now is growing again. It's redeveloping. There's new things coming into the city. Shingles Creek Crossing is one of them. Where the Brookdale Mall used to be. We're looking at a senior high-rise assisted living type structure. We have 32 acres just north of where Kohl's is that we're looking at redeveloping as well. And the city over the last 10 years has taken the tact of trying to spur redevelopment. We use TIF dollars extensively, and we have a commitment to redevelopment to rejuvenate our city. So
And our area has several inner ring cities or second ring cities, and they're all facing some of those same areas of need and things that you need to do to keep moving your city forward.
Yep, absolutely. In our case, we're a first-ring suburb. We're just north of Minneapolis. We share a border with them. Housing and affordable housing is another key thing that we take great pride in. About 85% of Brooklyn Center is affordable based on the Met Council statistics. And we'd like to keep our housing stock.
Well, we'll start out with some areas of redevelopment that you've already alluded to, and then we'll put some flesh on the bones.
Sounds good.
We'll start out with what you've called your opportunity site.
Yes.
Now, kind of describe where it is, because people in Brooklyn Center maybe have heard that term a lot, but people outside of the area might not know that area. So maybe you can describe it and place it in people's
If you're familiar with Brooklyn Center, it used to be a Ford dealership right along Bass Lake Road. And that was the first property that the city acquired a few years ago. just north of that now, there used to be a Circuit City, a Pep Boys, an underutilized strip mall, a couple of theaters that used to be in there as well. So now the city has acquired that property. We've cleared the land so that it's ready for redevelopment. We're working with developers, a developer at the moment, to put plans together and start that process to redevelop that whole area.
Right.
We're also looking at what would go in that area.
Oh, right. And now, how large is that site?
32 acres.
Oh, so that's fairly good size.
It's fairly aggressive. It's fairly large, at least for us.
Right.
We estimate $100, $120 million or more will go into that just in the first couple of phases. And we're looking at putting in somewhere around 750 to 800 market rate apartment structures along with a an arts building of some sort so that we can build and be more in tune with the arts with our residents.
And that'd be a kind of a new area that you're moving into, right?
Yep. It a lot of big plans,
right?
But it remains to be seen how it will actually turn out. But if the city doesn't take the lead and acquire the properties and move with redevelopment, it doesn't seem to happen.
Right. So. Well, and you've been with the city long enough that you've explored different ways of dealing with parts of the city that need to be changed and brought up to something that fits the current times.
Yeah, absolutely. If you recall, too, I had been on the Planning and Zoning Commission
its
chair
for
12 years before becoming the mayor. So I had a really good understanding of our city and how it works and where it was in the life cycle of the city.
Right. So. And so one thing, a term that people might run across is that you have a site plan concept. Mm-hmm. And that's what you've been describing about the apartments and stuff. And talk a little bit to this term and what it means for the whole unwinding of getting that redeveloped.
Yeah, we enter into an agreement in most cases with a developer to do what's called a site plan.
Right.
A good example of that is Shingle Creek Crossings because there was a site plan there. Most of the pads that were laid out in that plan have been filled. There are a few that we're hoping restaurants will come into along Shingle Creek itself. But that's the plan and the vision then for what that area may look like 10 to 15 to 20 years from now.
Right. So. And so the city comes up with a plan, and then the next stage is they have to find a developer that would like to do something like your plan or possibly make some changes in it?
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
Usually that's a kind of a symbiotic relationship where we're working with a developer, and in this case the developer has a letter of intent, which kind of starts that whole ball rolling.
Right.
And then the council, in and of itself, has determined what they think they would like to see there. And some of that is a special analysis has been done to go out and look and see what the market will bear for that type of property.
Right. So it's going to be a mixture of residential, mainly apartments, or homes?
Well, we call it mixed use.
Okay.
So there will be apartments. It's conceivable there'll be townhouses.
Okay.
It's also conceivable there'll be light businesses or small businesses as well. Council's leaving its options open as much as possible in order to put into place a redevelopment that's going to work.
So now, have you gotten to the point where you have a developer that is ready to work on this project?
Yeah, we do.
Okay, because that's what I was thinking, but I wasn't sure.
Yeah, they're working with us, but that's no guarantee that's what we'll wind up with. We saw that with Brookdale when we did the redevelopment there. We had a developer couldn't get funding and stuff and went out of business, and then we got another developer, and now we finally got the developer that has made it all work.
And so for this opportunity site, you have a developer that has a certain amount of time to put all their plans together and get the funding and be ready to go, right?
Yes. we're a little bit liberal on that, where, you know, we'll give them a year or two if we need to. When you're talking millions of dollars, it isn't a snap decision overnight. But we'll work with them, and then eventually we'll get to this developer's agreement, where we'll say in 5 years you have this done, or in 10 years you have, you know, the site fully redeveloped.
Right. Yeah, because there's a very significant series of steps that has to be carried out. So you can be in that development process for a year or two before anybody sees anything happening, right?
Oh, yeah, before any construction is done. Yeah, absolutely. It takes... it takes a year, two, maybe three, even just to get the financing in order.
So it's a complex process that you need staff people with a lot of good experience, right?
And we've been real fortunate, by the way, Juanita, with the fact that we've had some very good staff who are very proficient in doing redevelopment. Our director of redevelopment, Gary Idol, has been instrumental in making a lot of these redevelopments work. He first came on board and was part of the FBI regional headquarters and made all that work. And I think I've commented on this show before that we sold the land to that developer for a dollar, and it was the best dollar we ever made.
Well, and this whole process, when you get to the end of the line, is going to increase your tax base, right?
Yeah, and that's a really good point, because we have a new Marriott coming in.
We were going to touch on that,
And that property is not using TIF dollars. So as the taxes come in, it will
go to county,
school districts,
And now, maybe you can mention a little bit about what opportunities are there for citizen input into a project like the Opportunity Site.
Well, you certainly have your council and council members to be talking to. And we have a number of public hearings that we will be doing to generate that conversation as to what will go into this project and others as well. And that's where citizens should get involved. The other place where they should get involved is on our commissions.
Oh, definitely.
And we always have a bit of a struggle to fill those commissions with citizen input. But there's planning and zoning, there's housing, there's financial, there's park and rec. Places where you can be a part of that conversation and have some input into how that conversation winds up.
Now, another area of redevelopment, because you've had a lot of things going over the last few years that I can attest to from each time that we visit together, but it's called the Sanctuary of Brooklyn Center.
And
you referred to that as we started, but maybe you can tell us a little bit about where this process, where the sanctuary is going to be at.
Yeah, it used to be the Cars for Heart site. There used to be a dealership on that property before that. It's right along Brooklyn Boulevard. And the address won't come to me at the moment, but we are looking and working with a developer there to structure and build an 185, I think, apartment complex for senior housing and assisted living. Some of it will be higher end assisted living, like 24, 25 apartments too. Something that Brooklyn Center over the years has talked about having in our city, and something the residents have wanted for quite some time, because as people retire in Brooklyn Center, they'd like to stay in Brooklyn Center. And there's not much for facility to do that once it becomes real difficult to be in your home.
So it's a good addition then to the types of housing that your city has.
We look at housing across the board. This is a senior housing piece. We'll talk briefly about market value housing. We have an excellent source of starter homes and affordable housing now.
Did the city council and staff determine that that's the direction you wanted to go, or did a developer come to you and say, that's what I'd like to do?
No, that's the city staff and the council basically has set policy. the first year I was in office, even we set that to say we want to get a better, diverse housing in Brooklyn Center for all the obvious reasons: your tax base, your local economy, different people, different at different levels of professionalism, and different pay, and all of those things make for a better community.
Yeah, because you could go either way when you were working on a development project.
Yep, absolutely.
And so what developer did the city council choose?
Oh, I can't tell you that.
Oh, okay. we'll
it's worry, one of those secret things.
Okay. Where is it in the process?
Yes.
Where is it as it goes along?
Yes.
Because you have a developer.
Yes, we have a developer.
So where are you at in the process we were alluding to with the other project?
Yeah, they're looking at their financing right now, and they've come up with a couple of different strategies for financing. And the last I heard, the city, along with that developer, was working at a solution to the financing and moving it forward. And staff was optimistic about it.
Right, so. Yeah, because there's a whole series of things that need to happen before you're going to make something public.
Yeah, absolutely.
Because if you don't have all, your ducks in a row?
Yeah, well, even then, it's the risk that developer's taking. And of course, that builds into the stock market, into everything else.
Right.
So they're leery at saying, well, it's going to be us, and then maybe it's not them.
Yeah, until you get to where you actually sign, what is it, a something agreement?
Developer's agreement.
Developer's agreement.
Yep.
Then at that point, then it moves into the public eye.
Yep, if not a little bit before that.
Right.
It all depends on how the developer would like to announce
it. Oh, certainly.
And interesting enough, when we did the FBI building, a year before we could say anything as a city, my city manager and Gary Idle, I was talking about, we made the commitment with the federal government to allow this development to happen.
Okay.
The FBI said you can't say anything.
Oh.
And it was a whole year we couldn't say anything. So people would ask about that.
What's happening there?
Yeah, absolutely. I'd get that question a lot, and I'd say, well, there's a developer looking at it. We're hopeful a major development's coming. And we had to wait for them to be comfortable to announce it. So.
And there's all these details that need to get pinned down and to everybody's agreement. And
The lawyers, documents, you know, it's a lot of paperwork that goes with it as well, especially when you're talking hundreds of millions of dollars.
Right.
So.
Yeah, these are big investments. These are not small investments.
Yep.
Now, moving to Earl Brown Center, and that's where you were referring to, that there's going to be another hotel being moved into that area.
Yes.
Now, what's at, because the Earl Brown Center's there, and I know there's an Embassy Suites. What other kind of buildings are in that area?
Mostly it's Earl Brown.
Okay.
There'll be this Marriott that'll be there, and then Embassy Suites will fill that kind of circle. A little farther to the west are banking facilities and office complexes. But there's a pond right in the middle of that, the Earl Brown Pond.
Right.
And we put a water amenity in there that sprays water and stuff. Well, this is the last portion to be redeveloped. And the council, not the council I'm on, it was before I was in office, had determined that that's where a hotel-motel type arrangement could go. And it's taken almost 20 years to get it in there. So now it looks like it's going to go forward. We've got great commitment so far. The Marriott people, would like to see this built and in operation yet this fall.
Oh, wow.
So they can work out all the bugs and be ready for 2018 Super Bowl.
Right.
So you don't think Super Bowl generates a lot of, you know, out in Brooklyn Center, but it does.
Right.
You know, people are talking about
it. Yeah, you wouldn't think about that.
Yep.
Well, and that whole area, a lot of groups and a lot of conferences use that area.
Oh, Earl Brown has done exceedingly well now. A lot of weddings, a lot of individual functions for pneumesticists, just as an example.
Right.
Pharmaceutical people have been in there as well. It's just a site that gets used a lot. Mm-hmm. It's a very good premier meeting location. And it's in Brooklyn Center and part of our heritage.
Right. Yeah. From your history to the current times,
yep,
right?
That's right. So.
And so they haven't started constructing yet, but they hope to?
They hope to have it up and running this fall.
Wow.
Yet. Yes.
So, but have they begun the construction?
No, not yet.
Okay.
No.
They're going to have a full speed ahead operation.
Yeah, they're pretty aggressive in their timeline, and that tells me two things. One is they really want to put it in there.
Right.
And the other is that by being that aggressive in the timeline, there will be some good wages and good jobs that will be there,
that's
too.
That's true. All of these places that are being built bring jobs into your city.
Oh, yes.
And once they're built, they will bring some permanent jobs, too.
Yes.
I think cities are looking more into that aspect nowadays than they did in the past, don't you think?
Well, I know we are, because I mentioned restaurants in the Shingle Creek Crossing site, and there's a couple of pads there. In order to support those restaurants, we've got to have a good, strong local economy.
Oh, yes.
So the more jobs we can bring in, redevelopment we can do, the stronger a local economy is, which means it'll support restaurants to come in.
Right, too. Yeah, that's important.
Yep.
Now, your city has been, for quite a few years, actively reaching out to citizens by going around to like four different parks each summer?
Yes.
Let's talk just a little bit about that, because I don't think all of our cities do that.
Yeah.
Because I think we're stressing the fact that citizens need to get involved, but from the council and staff out and from the citizens in. And I know that your city has done that in the past, so I thought maybe we could talk about that a little bit.
Yeah, we do have four neighborhood meetings. Okay. We go to a different park for each one, and we have 12 different parks, or 16 different parks. And we've gotten through all of them once already, and we're going back through them again. But there's an opportunity to come out and have pizza with city staff. The police department about 9 years ago started this, and then it evolved from there to where now we have each department head there, and they're providing information on what their departments are doing, and how the city's being run, how it operates. You can ask questions, you can get involved at that point. It's a great opportunity then to hear from the people who are actually running our city.
Well, and you've had a good response from people, right?
Yes.
Because sometimes people say, nobody shows up. But your city has had a good response from citizens wanting to learn about things. You're reaching them in their neighborhood.
Yep.
But also, you're bringing information out to them that sometimes people don't think you can get a response, but you do.
Yeah, exactly. And we've taken the tact where it's very hard to get citizens to come into City Hall.
Right.
Or to the community center. So we're bringing that information to them and their neighborhoods.
Right.
We have another program that we've put together, and we have a van that will be visiting the parks for activities out of the community center. We got a grant for the vehicle out of Hennepin County. Brooklyn Park did as well. Both of us did. So rather than having citizens, kids, children, whatever, come to the community center, which isn't always possible from a transportation perspective, we're going to go to each park. And my understanding is already they've built a huge clientele of at least kids and activity in those parks that they visit. So,
you've got looked at different ways to do outreach.
Yes, absolutely. And, that's pretty tricky as well. You get a lot of times, people are just busy.
Right.
Families now, both parents are working.
Definitely.
And, it's hard to make meetings, move kids around, or do transportation things. So, yep.
And then having a little food never hurts, right?
That's right, yes.
Figure out what works, and then you can get more information out to your citizens, and they can get information back to you.
Yes. And that snowballs from there, too. Right. You know, we'll have 100, 150, maybe 200 people that'll come out for a neighborhood meeting, but they talk to their neighbors and others who aren't there as well. So it's a good way of disseminating.
Yeah, because I think that your city has some of the bigger responses in terms of that, don't you think?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I do, too.
I mean, from what I've talked with people about.
Yep.
And we'll finish up by touching base on something you already referred to, but I think it's important, about the commissions.
Oh, yes.
Okay, now let's go over what they are again, and the fact that people can go to those meetings, they can find out about them on the website?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. There are five different commissions. Mm-hmm. One is the Charter Commission that the mayor does not appoint to.
Okay.
The Chief Justice for Hennepin County appoints people who have applied to that. But that Charter Commission deals with the city's charter and is a great place to understand how the city works,
definitely.
How its charter is there, and then to make change if there's that sort of willingness within the community to do so. Our other commissions are Park and Rec, Financial, now that I gotta think of them, Park and Rec, Financial,
Human Rights?
No, we don't have a human rights one yet, although we are talking about it and looking at how we can better incorporate diversity within the city. Human Rights Commission or Council may be an area that we'll go to. But there's Planning and Zoning.
Oh, right.
There's Housing, that's the one I was...
Right.
Planning and Zoning, Housing, Charter Commission. trying to rattle them off is just difficult.
but now all of these commissions meet each month, right?
Yeah, they meet.
Or close to monthly.
Yeah, Planning and Zoning may be twice a month, depending on what the volume is. But as redevelopment happens in the city, it goes to the Planning and Zoning.
Right.
And redevelopment could be a variance for somebody putting an addition on their house or a major... like the FBI building or something on that order. So that's one of the commissions that holds public hearings on the redevelopment that's occurring in the city. Housing is another commission that we have that deals with housing issues across the city. And actually it works pretty closely with planning and zoning and how that housing should look and work. Park and Rec, of course, are all the park, the recs, the activities. Things that happen there. And then the Financial Commission, of course, helps us with the city budget. And that process, as we talked about earlier, has already started.
Right. So now what people can do is they can go to these meetings and talk to people, or they can look at the minutes of the meetings. Mm-hmm. But find something that's of interest to you, because you need people that stick with it, right?
Yeah, absolutely. And these are all open public meetings.
Right, right. Yeah, so they're all open to the public. That's what I wanted to
stress. You don't have to be a commission member to go to them. Absolutely.
Well, thank you very much. Yes. I appreciate your time and your information about your city. And we'll ask you to tune in next week for part two on Brooklyn Center's issues. We're glad that you've been with us and hope you'll join us again. Bye.